a Liverpool band who are still going strong after 40 years. Its founding members met at St Kevin's Comprehensive Boys' School in Kirby on Merseyside in 1976. Despite numerous lineup changes of the band, these two have remained a constant. Citing influences such as Magazine, David Bowie, Brian Eno, Talking Heads, and Steely Dan, and they actually got to work with Steely Dan founding member Walter Becker, who was a fully fledged band member for a while. They've toured with the likes of Simple Minds, Police, OMD. From their breakthrough single, African and White, in 1981-82, they are well known for their massive hits Wishful Thinking, Black Man Ray, King in a Catholic Style, Christian. They've had 11 top 50 singles and 3 top 40 albums. They've just finished a North American tour, and we are delighted to say that they're joining us at Forever Young in July in Kildare. Ladies and gentlemen, I am, of course, talking about Eddie London and Gary Daly of China Crisis. Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
Some introduction.
Well, you know, we're very delighted to have you here today to answer a few of our questions that have been sent in by our audience. You're very popular in Ireland, so we wanted to share some of their questions with you and find out a little bit more about you. So one question that everybody always asks is, where does the name come from?
Oh, God. It actually came from a friend of ours, whose name is Mike Douglas. He put the actual words together, and he went on to play with the Human League and OMD. Okay. But he was a friend of ours in Kirby, which is a new town just on the outside of Liverpool. And just like, you know, all good names or whatever, it was one night in the pub after we finished the writing session and that. And we were kind of always interested in, like, you know, the mysterious, the East and all that kind of thing. And after, you know, many attempts of putting Russia this, China that, he collected the words together and we kept it from that day.
Okay, super.
Simple as that.
So then, you know, being together for 4 decades now, Gary and Eddie, did you think you would endure this sort of length of career in the music industry as China Crisis?
God, no.
And what's kept you two together? What's kept you two together?
Well, we certainly didn't think it would last this long, but you don't as a young person, do you? I mean, you do, because you think everything. When you're a young person, I think, even when you're a teenager and a young teenager and you're with your friends, you just imagine that is life forever, because you don't think of forever. You're just in it. And it was the same with the group, really. We were very sort of, because we'd been to school together, and then we had our brothers working with us as well. And the two lads that joined us, Kevin Wilkinson and Gaza Johnson, they were like older brothers. So we were very much like a family sort of unit, really. So we just sort of went through the successful bit of it as like, you know, well, this is going to last forever. But you don't think it's going to last forever. You just think this is what we're doing. This is just what we're doing. And it's only when 40 years have passed like you suddenly go, oh, my God, it's been all that time. And you know what? We didn't really realise it was all that time until we were travelling on a plane, flying on a plane to Ireland in March 2020. And Eddie was already in Dublin and messaged us not to enter Ireland, to go straight to the Aer Lingus desk once we'd landed and get a flight back, because they were shutting Ireland down because of this thing called COVID and the pandemic. And I tell you, it was only when we were sat at home for about the first 3 months and I suddenly realised, oh my God, I'm nearly 60. Oh, we've been going for nearly 40 years. Oh my God. I had no idea. I know that sounds bizarre, but you don't really, because isn't that what John Lennon said? You know, life's what happens to you while you're busy making other plans.
Very true.
Do you know what I mean? We will have been going through our lives just going, here's the kids coming and here's them and they're getting older and our brothers, oh gosh, you know, parents die. You know what I mean? It's just, you're going through it all, and it's only when you stop that you realise, and we didn't stop. until the government of the world made everybody stop.
Yeah.
And I bet you that is what happened to a lot of people, isn't it? Because that's what you keep hearing about, like job shortages and stuff like that, is that people did stop and suddenly realize, I've been doing this forever. I don't want to do it anymore. Mm. And do you know what I mean? All these kind of things, and people retiring early and stuff like that. Fortunately, we didn't really have those ideas. We were more sort of like, hang on, we need to actually work again. We need to actually get back to what it was we were doing, really. And we didn't really know what that was going to be like at all, really. And the thing of longevity and what makes it work is the fact it's work. That's what makes it work. You're very lucky if you grow up and you have it instilled in you. Like Eddie and myself, we would have been Irish Catholic families. I know our family was. I think Ed's was. And that's sort of instilled in you, really. My dad's dad was Irish. My wife, Jeannie, dad was from Belfast. She's one of five sisters. So we're very sort of fortunate as we grew up. You went to school, you went to church, and then eventually you go to work. There's no highfalutin ideas. If you're going to be an artist or you're going to sing or you're going to take the stage, you're going to work. So, you know what I mean? That's been instilled in us, really. As much as, you know, as an older fella now, I do look at some of my contemporaries from the 80s, and they don't really work. They don't really work. Not really. They sort of sit around leisurely, you know, on bar stools and stuff like that, and recount tales and stuff. And I'm sort of very envious of them, really, because I'm like, God, wouldn't that be great, hey, to sit around just on your arse all day and, you know, not really work and not really, you know, get your bones on in and out of cars and vans and planes and
not dishing any dirt, I'm just looking at the thing behind you and I'm looking,
let me just check who I can have a pop at. There's nobody there. They're all good, hard working lads and girls, all of them, apart from maybe that one up there just behind your head.
Oh dear. Well, I mean, talking about being in Dublin, you know, when COVID hit, I mean, in recent years, you have done tours with lots of intimate venues like Whelan's Dublin, the venue in Cork in 2018, where I actually met you for the first time and came up after the gig and sort of said, I'm putting on a festival in Ireland, do you fancy it? And
I remember, fabulously.
you came along. So how does that compare with playing big retro gigs and tours, doing the intimate venues?
Oh, that's kind of our bread and butter, really. You know, obviously, different places throughout the world, you're more successful in some and less successful in others. And we've kind of, as Gary was saying, with all the arts work and that, we've become very, very chameleon, very, very adaptable to all situations, really. We can scale down the band, we can make the band bigger, depending on the venues and everything. And obviously, like every job in the world, it all comes down to budgets, doesn't it? You know, sometimes we can't go to like Australia, New Zealand, or the States, Mexico with a full big band because it's just not financially feasible to do so. So we have to scale it down. And other times in the UK, we can afford to have the bigger bands and do the bigger venues and that. So we've just become very, very adaptable. And don't get us wrong, both are equally as good, you know what I mean? It's great to do massive gigs and all that, but small intimate ones are really exciting too.
Ed, brilliant. I've got to draw your attention to the fact that you've just managed to fuse the two words feasible and visa. You said, it's just not feasible.
Which it isn't.
That's a new word.
There you go.
It just isn't feasible to do all these things.
That's a new word. Then it'd probably take off. Absolutely.
Do you know, the thing is about your job is, you know, performing for people and playing your songs is it's the same job whether there's six people there or 6,000 people there. It's no different at all. Yeah, it's different as in, you know, God, I'm a bit nervous now. There's 14,000 people out there or something, you know, and we're going to go on the stage and we're going to act like we really know what we're doing, which is like, You do know what you're doing every time you go on stage, but every time you go on, it's different.
Yeah.
I think that's what we've learned. I think that's what the longevity thing is. And I think that's why we do work in and out of small venues to big things, is that we have learned over all those years, which some of the bands haven't had to do, you know, the OMDs and the Human Leaves, they haven't had to really do that. You know, because they scored big time in the 80s, so they didn't really have to do the, you know, the hard slog. They did it at the very beginning of their career. We decided to do it at the end of our career.
Well, I've got a
but
question.
It is a thing of enjoying, you know, each experience, really. And we have learned to do that. It's not like we suddenly turn up and go, oh, God, it's not the London Palladium, is it? Not really, we don't really have that attitude, really. Do you know what I mean? And if it's a big festival like yourselves, it's always a bit, ooh, this is a bit exciting, you know. Yeah, just the backstage is exciting, you know what I mean? Just the fact that Holly Johnson's just turned up or Phil Oakey, do you know what I mean? It's always a bit, whoa.
Oh, well, the first question from our audience, Damien has asked, can you tell us the story behind Black Man Ray and who inspired it?
Yeah, right. So Black Man Ray would have been, I would have been in my mum's house, still in my mum's house. With this, only been 21, maybe 10, 22. Would have had the drum machine set up, synthesizer set up. Would have started the tune on the bass synthesizer. Wouldn't have known it was a song called Black Man Ray because it would have been recorded instrumentally. And then I remember at the time, sort of, I was always interested in art, and I would have done art at school, secondary school. So from when I was about 13 to 16, I would have done it. So I would have known vaguely who Man Ray was. And then I would have had a magazine, photography magazine, and it was all about his Raya vision, which is solarization or something like that, where he reversed photographs. Yeah. So instead of them sort of being black and white, they were sort of silver and black. And, you know, it was like a negative kind of thing. So that was immediately interesting. And then I would have seen a Ray Charles thing. And then I would have just put the two names together, really. And then just sang about being in the group.
Okay.
And we believe in Black Man Ray. We're not happy in our own way. And we're the people of reason why. We forever change as time goes. But yeah, I could be wrong. Yeah. Why should I pretend? God only knows in the end. And it basically, Florent was a lot. We weren't dads yet, and we'd been in the band, and we're on to our third album. So by the time we come to Florent, we were singing about suddenly our experiences of the working world and our working world and our touring and all this kind of thing. You know, Ed and myself hadn't really been outside of Kirby and Liverpool a lot, really. And then within 2-3 years, we'd been almost around the world and playing with everybody from the likes of the Police to Simple Minds, to the Eurythmics, to
Bowie
and Santana, all these kind of people. So all of a sudden it was not singing about how we were, where we were from and who we were and our girlfriends and our friends and the industrial estate and the school we went to and what we thought of, what we understood of politics. All of a sudden it was like, my God, we've been to New York. We've driven around LA. And you know what I mean? So you'd be sort of talking about those experiences and how unhappy it made you touring and stuff like that because you were away from home for a long time. Mm-hmm. So all of that is like, you know, are we happy? And I feel a bit miserable, but how can you be miserable? You're in and out the charts. Mm-hmm. What the hell are you talking about? This is dreams come true for some people. I think Ed and myself genuinely didn't sort of grow up and start music to think we want to be in the charts. We want to be our singles in the charts because the bands that we liked, they weren't necessarily jumping into the charts. It was their albums you were into and stuff, yeah. You know. So, yeah, it was just about that, really, in my way.
Okay. So next up, we've got a question from Mick.
Hi, Gary and Eddie. Mick here in Laois in Ireland. Great that you're coming back to Forever Young. Just have a quick question. I was at the Echo Arena in 2008 when you sang and donated the track Starry-Eyed to the Liverpool Number One project. Just wondering why you chose that song or were you voluntold? And have you recorded any other covers seeing as you're such a prolific songwriting duo?
The project itself was based on Liverpool artists that have had number one throughout the history of the hit parades. So they had different acts covering different, you know, people covering the Beatles, people covering Cilla Black, people covering Billy Fiore, everyone really. That was one of the most obscure ones there out of all of them that had been number one. Gary had heard it, and Gary suggested that we do that one, which I thought was a stroke of genius, because I think everyone at the time was going for the more obvious ones, you know, going for Beatles tracks and things like that.
Some were already taken as well, weren't they?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Some of the bigger bands, OMD and stuff like that, they'd already, some of the tracks were already taken. And I remember by the time it got to us, we had a choice of so many tracks. Do you know what I mean? So that one did stick out, like.
Yeah, so we chose it for no other reason than that, and it being a great song. The answer to the second part of your question, we had done another cover, actually. Well, we done two under the radar. We did one of the Carole King song, It's Too Late, which was it was on an 80s album. Again, it was all kinds of 80s artists doing covers of mainly 70s hits like Carole King, the Doobie Brothers, all that kind of stuff. And there was everyone on that, from Evan 17 ABC. To ABC to ourselves. We did a great version. You should check it out, actually. But the remit of that was, it had to be done in your style. You couldn't just cover the song as Carole King did it, for instance. You had to make it sound like perhaps that you'd written it. And we based it on our first hit single, Christian, which was like a big ballad of ours that came out, our actual first hit single. And we kind of based it on that. So you'll hear Carole King sounding a lot like, well, not Carole King, you hear our rendition of Carole King sounding a lot like Christian. So we did that. And we also did Be My Wife or something like that.
Yeah, Bowie.
About a Bowie thing. But in the history of China Crisis, because we do our own songs, we've only ever done them three cover versions to date. That's all we've ever done.
The great thing about the Carole King one is that we actually do a song in our set called It's Never Too Late.
It's a nice bit.
We should put the Carole King one back in the set and play them one after each other.
Okay, next question. Do you think there's extra pressure on Liverpool bands to be successful, given the city's musical legacy?
No, I don't either. No. I mean, no. Okay, well, honestly, because okay, the Beatles were huge, and Jerry and the Pacemakers and all that kind of thing. And they did have a great 80s with Frankie Goes to Hollywood, with OMD, with ourselves, with the Bunnymen. You know, the list goes on. But if you do your research, I think every other city's had that as well. If you look at Glasgow, you look at London, you look at Sheffield, look at Newcastle, they've all got great histories in music. I think just the microscope is on Liverpool, really. I don't know why, but and it is a really successful city, but there's many other cities throughout the UK that have had, you know, just as much success. Maybe not the Beatles, but certainly a lot of success.
Okay.
So I'm totally with Gary with that now. The pressure isn't on, really.
Okay, well, our next question is from Mark.
Hi, Gary and Eddie. My name's Mark. And first of all, I just want to thank you guys for an amazingly personal and cosy evening in the theatre at Bury St Edmunds last year, where, as well as playing your wonderful music, you were showing a slideshow of your life, effectively. It was very, very personal. It was lovely. Now, my favourite album is Working With Fire And Steel. So my question to you, of all your albums, which is your favourite and why? Thanks.
First album, Difficult Shapes and Passive Rhythms, only because it's the memories of it so lovely for me, really. And it, to me, it just sounds so fearless and buoyant, and a bit sort of, I only have to, I never listen to it. So occasionally when I do, I nearly cry sometimes because it's like, it's just so wild the way we just don't sound like, there's like a couple of songs sound like us a certain way. And then three songs sound like us another way. And then two songs sound like us another way. And that was Ed and myself being determined to sort of try and sound the way we wanted to sound. And we couldn't get it right at all because we kept leapfrogging all these producers. But I think that was sort of like a great indicator of sort of how determined we were going to be to sort of make our songs the best they could be. Do you know what I mean? Whereas other bands, the Bunnymen or the Teardrops or OMD, they had a determined sound. They were a band. They had a drummer. They had amps. They had big guitars. And do you know what I mean? They sounded a certain way. Whereas Ed and myself, we had a little four-track recorder, a synthesizer, a drum machine, a guitar, and a bass guitar. And we kept writing these songs that could sound like anything and everyone. And I think you can hear it all on that record, really. And I think it's like, it's just too lovely, really. It's just too immensely lovely.
Oh, that's brilliant.
I haven't particularly got a favourite one. Mine would be an amalgamation of tracks from different albums. So some of Florence, some of Fire and Steel, some... off Typical Shapes, yeah. Some off Autumn. You know, I think Autumn's a great album, the last album we've just done. I think it's right up there and as good as anything we've ever done. It'll be like kind of a best of, really.
Compilation
What's
album.
What's your favourite album? The Greatest Day. I'll be honest with you, man. The greatest hit.
The comedy sketch somewhere.
It is now.
Oh, dear. Right, we've got a question from Catherine. So, to Eddie, you're a teaching fellow in songwriting at LIPA. Do you enjoy the world of academia? And which song of yours and another artist do you feel demonstrates perfect songwriting? There's a loaded question.
I definitely don't believe in the perfect song. I don't think that we've reached it yet or whatever, if you ever do. The songs are, you know, they kind of really transient in that. It's great if they last, if they have longevity, the song, and it, you know, and it's great. And
I do hear it in songs. Do you ever hear a song and you sort of, I sometimes listen, you know, and I'm sort of like, the perfectness of what they've done in the song blows my mind a bit, really, because I think, how have they done that? It's like it couldn't be more perfect. You know, like classic ones, you know, like Earth, Wind and Fire.
Oh, yeah.
It's just like devastatingly brilliant. And you're like, how the hell is this? But yeah.
It's great. It's kind of things like that, they evoke memories and everything of the time. I think there is certain elements, and this comes into the songwriting thing with the academic side of it. There is definitely elements to a song. It needs strong melody. It needs, you know, strong harmony. It needs good structure. It needs good lyrics and things. So these elements that you need within a song to make it work. And generally, that is the rule of foot, really, is that, you know, all great songs, all great canon of songs, whether it be Smokey Robinson, Stevie Wonder and all that, they will always be memorable in certain ways. You know, it'll all have that certain ingredients where it's melodically correct and everything. I do like doing, not too much of it these days, the academia side of it. And I do like listening to new kids coming through, you know, new little artists and all that in the future. I think that's great. You know, it's such a difficult industry. I sometimes wonder, do they know really what they're getting into? You know, because times are very, very different from when me and Gary started and all that. And, you know, all praise to them, you know, it needs to carry on and people do need to be, to, you know, let off that steam and let out the creativeness.
Are you getting that thing, are you ever getting that thing, you know, that with the age we are now, where you hear some songs and you think, Right, well, I never need to hear that ever again.
All the time.
Well, that's a new thing, isn't it? Do you know what I mean? It's sort of on the same thread, isn't it? About, you know, the songs you think of this and the art of it. Yeah. And there's also the downside, which is like, don't ever let me hear that ever again. I've heard that enough now. Elton John, Saturday Night's All Right for Fighting. Don't ever play that in my ears ever again.
and the thing is, the challenge with the new kids and all that kind of thing, new kids, the challenge with that is they all go in with the same ambition. You know what I mean? Probably 99.9% of them want to be actually quite a different ambition from what being Gary has, because we never, as Gary said earlier on, we never imagined, you know, that we were going to be a chart group or whatever. We just did it for the love and that of the music. But I'd say more so now that probably 99.9% of them, of the kids I see, they do want to be a pop star. They yeah. do think that they're the best thing since sliced bread.
Yeah, I bet they understand it a lot better, don't they? Like, it's a career.
Yeah.
They can be successful and, you know what I mean, stuff like that. Whereas ours was just more in the music, wasn't it? You know, we most probably could have done with a bit more sort of legal advice and all this, you know, kind yeah. of thing, you know.
And that is the good thing about academia as well, actually. It's yeah. that the school, that the Paul McCartney School, the Liverpool Institute, it's not just all about the music. It things that me and Gary never had a clue yeah. about. It's the business side, it's the contractual side, it's how to make a living within the industry. You know, so a lot of the people that leave there, they might not have a great record career, but it gives them a firm ground and that they can perform live and they can go on and they can make a living out of what they love doing.
Yeah. No, brilliant.
Music's
a different world.
Yeah.
So our next question is from Glenn.
Glenn Morton here, formerly of, guess where? Yep, Liverpool, now Kildare. Looking forward to seeing you at the festival. Two questions. Obviously, you're going to play King in a Catholic style, please. And the second question relates to this. I got this on the year of issue and via my wife, who is an intensive care nurse at Walton Hospital, I managed to get it signed, but only by... Hang on 1 second. Eddie. Now, my question is, Gary, any chance of getting that signed at the festival? Cheers, boys. Bye.
Oh, for sure, for sure. Absolutely for sure. Just pass it through the little fence.
Of course.
Yeah, so he's obviously quite a fan, and he's got his signed album, but it's only got one signature, and, you know, you can't have a signed China Crisis CD of only one signature. So, right. Okay. So, Fran asks, there was 20 years between Walk by Success and the 2015 comeback pledge funded album, Autumn in the Neighbourhood. Why the long hiatus? And will we have to wait 20 years for the next new material?
Well, we're nearly waiting 10. Yeah, if it was 2015, it's 2023 now. Is that 8 years? So yeah. It's going to be at least 10. I'm not quite sure why it was 20 years, really. Not really sure why.
Kids, family,
work, blah, 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 all that stuff.
And the thing was, as well, you know, the records industry and everything had changed yeah. so much. Dance music was so powerful. We were often wondering, is there a place for us? Do people, I mean, that was the great thing about Pledge, is that we were thinking, do people really want another China Crisis album? And when you put it out to Pledge, there's kind of like a get out clause in that if you don't reach the target, you don't have to do the album. So it's so your answer's there, really, is that actually no one wants another China Crisis yeah. album. But it was completely the opposite. We put it out to them, and you know, within weeks it was like we'd surpassed the target threefold, and so we were obliged to do it. So happy that we did do it. Yeah, and that, you know, just life went on. I think the record industry, everything had changed. families, small families, all that kind of stuff. And
China Crisis as well didn't really have a live audience. You know, for how I remember it was we had like chart success and we had people come to see us because they'd seen us on Top of the Pops and they liked the records and they bought the albums. But as soon as that all ended, sort of 90, early 90s, the sort of, we were in a tour and live act that people went to see, not like Simple Minds or U2 or the Bunnymen. We weren't really that kind of act, really. We didn't have an audience of just old blokes that, you know, were madly into us and would buy every record. We weren't like that. We had an audience that was much more broad than that, really. And to this day, we've found them again, really. That's really what happened over those 20 years, I think, is that Ed and myself suddenly sort of woke up to the fact that our kids were getting bigger and we could play and that could be our job again. And that's what happened with the record. That sort of happened sort of a little bit after us getting back and playing and finding out that people did want to come and see us and hear us again and hear the songs again. And that's what's happened. And then especially the last 8 years since that album's been out, it's gone sort of like,
we've really built the audience. We haven't stopped playing. All the shows that we play all over the place are sold out. So we're proud of that. But
it's also finding who we are as well on stage. You know what I mean? We weren't known for our on-stage personalities or our live act, or, you know, nobody knew diddly squat really about us because we were just kids when they saw us. So as grown men, and then men getting older and touring, we had to sort of develop a way of, well, this is our show and this is how we do it. And I think that's what's happened over the last few years is like we're very different from absolutely everybody, I think. I think that's what's happened is when we're in a room, no matter what the room is, we make it our own. And it's not just about playing the songs. It's all about, this is it. We're in this room and we've got to have...
Give it the all.
We've got to have a great time. That's what it's about, really. It's the best part of the day. Do you know what I mean? We're not one of those bands that's got all the lights and got all the gear in the trucks and all the big theatres and all the bums on seats. So wherever we go in, that's the best bit of the day. That's the best bit. Don't worry about it. Don't be thinking this is too big, too small, too weird, too this. That's not it at all. We're in here. Are you in front of us now? Are we playing?
We'll play for the people that's there.
I think I think that's what the audiences are responding to, really, is that suddenly... We are this entity that is like, you know, it's all about that night. So if you do come and see us, it's like, it's going to happen. Whatever happens is going to happen, really.
Oh, lovely. Well, just to round up, you played our first festival, Forever Young, 2019. Do you have any standout memories of joining us in Kildare that weekend?
I remember it being an absolutely fantastic weekends. I mean, all credit to you for putting the festival on, by the way. We'd actually done, the weird thing is, we did your first festival. We opened up the first ever Rewind Festival as well, when that started. So we did your one, we did the first Rewinds. We carry on doing both.
I thought it was a great location. Yeah. I thought it was lovely.
And some really of the acts as well.
And the acts were great. I thought Holly Johnson being backstage was lovely. Holly's in, you know what I mean? He's a proper famous Liverpool fella for all the right reasons, you know what I mean? Really is. So him turning up was a bit special. And then I remember the Human League. I hadn't seen them. I'd never seen them really. Well, not since Dare. I'd seen them once doing Dare back in the 80s. So that was really exciting getting to see them. And then the fact that nobody could be backstage and the stage was all curtained off for them or something. So nobody was allowed to actually, you know, stand at the side and watch them. And I thought, you absolute.
But yeah, absolutely amazing festival.
Yeah, lovely.
Well, we don't do it like that. I remember, you know, some of you guys were down the front in 2019 parting away with everybody. So that's what we, you know, we try and make it a brilliant weekend for
I actually remember you coming up to us in Dublin as well and asking us if we were playing.
Yeah.
And I'm so happy we did, you know, obviously. And so many people, we were just in the States just a couple of weeks ago. And I was just in this bar. We went to watch the football just on the corner, me and Eric, the sax player. And an airline pilot coming from an Irish airline pilot came in. He was, you know, staying in New York overnight, obviously, because he'd just flown in or whatever. And he was, like, blown away, you know, that he came in and seen us and was asking about the Forever Young Festival and all that. And I said, yeah, we're doing it this year. So lots of people have asked, so they're really excited about it, you know, so it should be great fun.
That's lovely to hear. And we can't wait for you to be back. You know, it's July's coming very quickly. Know, details of where you're playing elsewhere, you know, are on your website. You're busy boys. You're out doing this tour. Wish you loads of luck with that. And we shall see you in July in Kildare at Forever Young. Thank you very much, guys.
Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen,
thank you.
Gary and Eddie, China Crisis. Thank you.
Thank you.